what there is an increase in temperature both on land and the sea. So that's what it confirmed, AR5. And these are being caused by human activity. So all this discussion about, no, nature has its own course, nature goes through the process of glaciation, that is ice age, and a process of heat, you know, non-glaciation, in between glacier periods. So nature goes through that, that's the counter denial. So it's very clear, the IPCC report says, climate change is happening because of human activities. It's far beyond what will happen naturally in the natural system. It is, and this is causing, this increase in temperature is causing, because where will the temperature hit first? I mean, the temperature will obviously hit where there's a lot of ice. So it will hit, you know, it will hit the polar ice caps, and the third, what we call the third pole, you know, the glaciers in the Himalayas or and Alp mountains, you know, these places where you have a lot of ice, and that ice is melting, and that because the ice is melting, it flows into the sea, and because of that, the sea is rising. Sea level is rising. So that's one of the things that it says, and this can cause a rise of 44 centimeters to 88 centimeters. Nothing to be alarmed by, around of 44 centimeters to 88 centimeters over the next 81 years. That is by year 2100. So that's what it says. And there would be, and this is something you have to be alarmed of. When I said you know, going to do alarm for sea level rise, I mean just that sea level rise per se, but there are a whole lot of factors which add to sea level rise. But what you have to be alarmed of is extreme weather events. And we last time we had a flood like the August 2018 flood, that was in 1924. So most of us, I mean, certainly not us. I must be one of the older people in this room, and I mean, we have no collective, no history about the last flood, and even our parents don't have history about the last flood. You know, so this is this, but it's not going to be once in 100 years anymore. You're going to have floods like what happened last year, once in 30 years, once in 25 years. So most of us, the 2018 floods was the first major flood we faced in our life, but it is certainly not going to be the only flood we are going to face in life. We are going to have far more such events happening. And what does it mean for Kochi? So there's this National Institute of Oceanography just next door to you. And their headquarters in Goa. They are the people who work on sea level rise in different parts of the country. And they say, and their study says, Kolkata has the highest sea level rise. That's for two reasons, because you know this also happens to be the Ganga Hubli basin. So there's a lot of water withdrawal there, and that is causing subsidence of land. That means the land is going down relative to the sea. And the sea level is rising, with the result that this area has the most amount of sea level rise. This is from past and the current projections. Next is Kochi area. And Kochi is also vulnerable, just as like Kolkata. Kochi is vulnerable because it has these estuarine water systems. You have the Vembanad Lake in these systems. So there, if you have excess drawer, you know, the land goes down and this can come up. Now the question that you will ask, can Kochi come 3.7 millimeters per year? And this is another NIO study, which sort of looked at projections of what if you know if we could project how much what impact it will have 1 meter rise in sea level and 1 meter rise in 2 meter rise in sea level, and it came with this. So I mean this is for 2 meters. I mean you need not worry too much about it, but just to understand. So all these areas you can see here all the areas marked red would be underwater if the sea was to rise by 2 meters, which means Kumbhalangi, which is somewhere here, am I right? Somewhere here, Kumbhalangi. Kumbhalangi nights will be Kumbhalangi nights forever, you know. So if that were to happen, Kumbhalangi nights will be complete, you know. So that's how it's going to happen. This is 2 meters. But some of you will ask, I mean, and I'm sure you're much better than me in mathematics. I mean, I wouldn't have been a journalist if I knew mathematics. You know? You would ask, you know, 3.7 millimeters, you know, put quick calculation, mental calculation, 3.7 millimeters per year into 2100 years. That comes to 30 centimeters, something like that. Maybe slightly lesser than 30 centimeters. I mean, you do this calculation, you know, but 30 centimeters, I mean, what are you talking about, 1 meter, 2 meters. So now, that's where we get into the next, and that's very important for us to understand. There is something called the real sea level rise and the effective sea level rise. The real sea level rise would be this figure, 44 centimeters to 88 centimeters or 30 centimeters, whatever. This is the real sea level rise. But the actions that we do, as Harish mentioned about mangroves, you know, the actions that we do, the garbage that we throw, all these things adds to this. And the total effect of sea level rise will be far more than this effective figure of, you know, 40 millimeters or 40 centimeters, 88 centimeters. So let's go into what are those actions which sort of increases the sea level rise. Destruction of mangroves, this is very, very important. I mean, mangroves are the last frontier to protect us from sea level. We'll go into mangroves in detail slightly later. Flattening of sandbars. So if you notice some parts which I mean, you know, the land does not go into the sea like this. Usually it goes like this, and just before the sea, there is a hump, and then it goes into the sea. This hump is the sandbar, and this is very critical for us to prevent the sea from coming inside. So if the sandbar you work, I mean, the relevance of course CRZ, I mean, if you were to cut that and you were to build houses there, you were to build a township there, then your sea comes inside that much more. So your effective sea level rise, a rise of half a meter there, will translate to a total rise of maybe 1 meter, 1.5 meter inside, just because you have removed that sand there. Construction edge of changing the contours and garbage clogging the water channel. So if you don't have water flowing out, fresh water flowing out, then there's more chance of seawater coming in, because ultimately this balance has to be maintained. And extreme rainfall bringing excess water through the river system. This is what happened in August 2018. We'll come to that. And excess withdrawal of groundwater causing subsidence of that. So this is like what happened in Kolkata, where the Hooghly Basin, which includes Bangladesh, because Bangladesh Sundarbans also sort of going down the Kolkata. That's their excess drawal of water is causing the subsidence, that, you know, the ground itself going down. And this can very easily happen in Kochi, because we are close to, you know, the Vembanad water system, the other estuarine system. So here, if you draw too much of water, the land can come down. Now, and this is, we all know this picture, Periyar Estate, the temple, you can hardly see the top of the temple. Now what happened, why did it flood in 2018? Now, if you just look at this is the India IMD, Meteorological Department graph. This is from June 1st. June 1st is the conventional date for onset of southwest monsoon. June 6th, we still don't have rains, but then that's a different story this year. So June 1st, if you look at this, if you look at the graph, this is what the average is. And this average is built over 50 to 100 years. This is the line. There you see, from here you start the growth, from around 6th, 7th of August, and then the pilgrim period. So by around 22nd of August, departure, you had 40.87% more rain than what should have happened, what should have happened on an average. So 40.87%, and in some districts which are very, very critical, in districts like Idukki, it went up to 96%. I mean, this is an average. So this is taking into account Trivandrum, which Thiruvananthapuram, which didn't have too much of rain, you know, or Kasaragod, which didn't have too much of rain. But Idukki, it went up to 93%, 94%, 95%. So that's, and all that water, if you remember that first photograph, satellite picture you saw, comes into this bowl in which Kochi is, you know, located. And once that hump was over, it was fairly normal. So by the end of southwest monsoon, by September 30th, it was only 23.34% extra than what it was. So this is what caused the rain. But was it only the rain that caused the floods? I mean, obviously there are more things. And this rain was also not same in all districts. Idukki, if you notice, had much higher. These are the averages, and this is what the actual rainfall was. Idukki, you see, is much higher than all the other districts. And that was just one cause. The other cause was the cascade of dams. You know, you had a series of dams, reservoirs, one after the other, after the other, after the other. So these, I've just taken the three river systems which flooded very badly. This is the Chalakudi river system. Periyar, so all the blues are Chalakudi river system. This is all the white, purple, violets are Periyar river system, and browns are Pampa river system. So, starting from upper Sholayar, and then this is Parambikulam, this is lower Sholayar, this is Perinalkuttur, and this side, starting from Mulla Periyar, Chirudoni, you know, likewise, and here the this is Kumbi, this is Mulla Periyar, and this is Chirudoni, and here the upper reaches of the Pamba system, and with connections, the last one being Tanir Mukham Barrage, you know. So this whole thing, none of these could hold the water. They had to release water one after the other. And that sort of added to this level of flooding. The three tools, very important for us, because for each one of our lives, because we will continue to, floods may come, floods will go, drought will come, drought will go, but we continue to live here till the end of our lives. So what are the three tools which we have? Kochi City just managed to escape floods. I mean, we're just watching it. I mean, we came up to edges of Kochi City, but Kochi City, I mean, up to Kalamashiri, up to Edappadi came, but then, you know, Kochi was just managed to escape. You may not be that lucky next time, no? Be careful. So, and last such major flood was in 1924, so we don't have the collective history in our mind. You know, we don't know. I mean, Yanad Achambaranagar did that. My father was alive, he would have been more than 100 years old today. So, I mean, I've heard my father talking of Tonnuchambadilta Vallapakam. Tonnuchambadilta Vallapakam is Malayalam, he has Tonnuchambadilta. And, but you know, that generation's gone, so we don't have collective memory about the floods. And the only way of people to withstand such events is to have climate resilience. What is climate resilience? Resilience is what we can do as individuals and through society and, you know, forcing our government, etc. So that we become resilient to climate change, so we can deal with climate change. So that's what we can do. What can we do? Now we strengthen tree cover. This is like a no-brainer. I mean, this is like a no-brainer, you know. Strengthen tree cover. I mean, if you don't strengthen tree cover, especially in a state like Kerala, because we again go back to that first slide. If you know, the ridge is about 1,300 meters, and the highest point is 2,600 meters. At that height, 20 meters, in a distance of less than 100 to 120 kilometers. You know, no other part in India has that kind of gradient. No other part in India has that kind of gradient, you know, from 100 to... On the same side, I mean, the river flowing from somewhere close to anamudi, if it's flowing towards the east, it will take 200-300 kilometers to reach the sea, whereas 300-400 kilometers to reach the sea, whereas from anamudi to this side, it takes 100-120. So that's a kind of gradient you have. And when you have a gradient like that, if you don't have, and you have monsoon with an average of 2800 millimeters, if you don't have structures to break that fall of water, and that's where your tree canopy and multiple canopies that we have helps the structure to break the flow force of water. If you don't have that, you know what happens is water falls on land, it washes away the soil, goes quickly into the river system and flows out into the sea. And you don't, and it falls, it goes off. The point is, a river is just a drainage channel. And what is a river? A river is basically, if I pour this glass of water here, it will find the lowest part going out from here. If I continue pouring the water, it will cut a channel on this table. Now that channel is a river. So water out. But what holds the water and what sort of releases the water slowly, that is what the forest do. That's what trees do. So if we don't have those trees, then you know that's going to. So for instance here on the upper meter of the Western Ghats, you'll see this kind of forest. This is a very, very unique ecosystem. You don't see it in many parts of the world. It's quite unique to Western Ghats. This is the Shola grassland ecosystem, where you have grasslands here, and on the crevice of the hills you have thick montane evergreen forest. And the combination of what happens is water falling here runs off very fast. From the grasslands it runs off very fast. And on the Shola, because thousands of years of leaves falling, there is this humus flow on the floor, there it slows down. And that means that streams that come out, so if there's a stream somewhere here, this is just upstream of Shalimala. Shalimala is on the other side. So Periyar Tiger Reserve, that's it. So if you have streams flowing here through a Shola forest, it will flow almost throughout the year. That's basically because the Shola grassland ecosystem has that impact on water dynamics. And the point is, if you remove the Sholas, then water falls, goes away, and you just don't have that function. And planting of native trees, that's very important. I mean, the trees which are off the land. And we have this example, this photo is from Chennai, where we had Cyclone Varada, and we lost, all these trees which were planted, these rain trees, etc. They were the first to fall. We lost something like 17,000 trees in Cyclone Varada. So that happens, and that causes. So I think you have seed bombs. So these kind of things are planting native species that you plant that sort of gives preserve riverbeds and lakes. And again, the same function basically to hold the water so that it is released. The point is, if you have 2,800 millimeters of rainfall, I mean last year we had 3,500 millimeters of rainfall, and then within 3 months you don't have water. We are all struggling for water in our wells, even now, So if you don't have water, then why is that happening? That's the question, that's the logical question we should ask. So that's where these, river bottoms and, large wetlands and the coal wetland village, that sort of help. So what our role is to sort of help it preserve these as much as possible. This is what Anish was talking about in that. These things ultimately land up in these Vembanad system or the other estuarine system. And this sort of clogs the river. And we saw the impact in Kottanad when the rain happened. What can we do to growing plant? This is how mangroves look in Kochi now. This is how it is. So the entire area here, these islands, had mangrove cover. And this sort of disappeared. Now we have construction via mangrove. And this is how a proper intact mangrove looks. This is in Chetua. And what the mangrove does is very important. They do a growing cluster. So you have, because of these roots here, you can see these small roots here, it traps silt that comes from upstream, and all the leaves that fall. So this platform keeps growing. It keeps growing naturally. So the platform grows naturally. And because of that, even if the sea level were to rise, this platform would have grown to keep pace with that. So that's the function that mangroves do to prevent sea level rise, and also to deal with tidal waves when you have cyclones. So this and if this was there, the port wouldn't have had silt. So that's what I mean. You build a port and not take mangroves into account, and you destroy the mangroves, then the port has silt. What's the point of port having silt? Because port ships cannot come inside if the port has silt. And they're very interesting because Kerala has only, I mean, we think Kerala will have a lot of mangroves, but Kerala has very little mangroves. Kerala has only 17 to 21 square kilometers of mangroves. That's all that is remaining now. Whereas a city like Mumbai, within the Mumbai, it's a metropolitan city like Mumbai, within its metropolitan area, has 75 square kilometers of mangroves. So that, I mean, as long as the mangroves are there, Mumbai is protected. We keep destroying the mangroves, we are not protected. So if you look at the mangrove map of India, this is mangrove map of Kerala. These are the areas where these patches still remain. Kannur being the most, having the most amount of mangrove. These are small patches here, we are here. Small patches here, and these are all losing. Every day, this is a losing battle. Mangroves are going away. And you have a small patch. So mangroves, if we can protect mangroves, or we can stop somebody from cutting a mangrove, I mean, that's the greatest service we can do to protect our own city from climate change. And mangroves, there are studies which have proved that mangroves protect areas from tsunami. So this is a study reported in Science magazine. This is a study in Kadalur coast, and this is the Kadalur coast, and areas which have had mangroves, the villages behind that, were not affected by the tidal waves of the 2004 tsunami. The areas the villages that did not have mangroves were badly affected. Like these villages were protected. So there's enough documented scientific evidence of how mangroves can protect from climate change. And what can we do to prevent? I mean, one other step is coastal erosion. I mean, if we can sort of look at a map and say, can I build my house not on the coast? Can I build it slightly? I mean, if we can, because this is very common in many parts of Kerala. This is again